Thank you all for attending from the press and the public, those who volunteered to come out today. My name is Robert McCaw. I'm the National Government Affairs Director with the Council on American-Islamic Relations, and I'll be emceeing today's press conference. Today marks the one-year anniversary of Jamal Khashoggi's murder in the Saudi Arabian consulate in Turkey in Istanbul. It was 1:14 p.m. in Turkey on October 2nd that Khashoggi was last seen entering the consulate alive. In November 2018, the Washington Post reported that the CIA had concluded Saudi Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman ordered the assassination of Khashoggi with high confidence. Khashoggi's murder continues to impact the press freedoms and human rights in Saudi Arabia and impact the state of U.S.-Saudi relations. We will first hear from our speakers, and then we'll open up for a Q&A from the press, followed by one-on-one availability to the media. I'm joined here today by Code Pink co-founder Medea Benjamin, American Muslims for Palestine National Policy Director Osama Abu Irshaid, Nonviolence International Human Rights Attorney Jonathan Kuttab, and Hassan Al Taib, Middle East Policy Lead at the Friends Committee on National Legislation. I want to open this moment with a moment of silence for Jamal Khashoggi. Again, 1 year ago, he walked into the Saudi consulate in Istanbul to obtain paperwork so he could marry his Turkish fiance, never to be seen again. On the anniversary of his murder, we are a reminder to the world, to the United States and to Saudi Arabia, that we have not yet achieved justice for Jamal. And we are prepared to fight this official indifference and silence with our courage and action. Khashoggi was a man who was a reporter, a rights activist, who believed in the freedom of people, the press, and in calling for accountability and reform in Saudi Arabia and the Middle East. He is now a martyr for the cause of free speech and reform in the Middle East and around the world. President Trump's willful indifference to the murder of an American resident by a U.S. ally is a shameful reminder that some in power will always choose economic opportunity, the sale of arms and oil, over human life and freedom. We now know an assassination team was dispatched by Saudi Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman, the de facto ruler of Saudi Arabia, to lay in wait in the consulate, where he was lured under false pretenses and assaulted, tortured, brutally murdered, and dissolved in acid to hide that crime. His last words captured on audio were, "I cannot breathe." He was butchered alive. Last October, the UN Special Rapporteur Agnes Callamard determined Khashoggi was a victim of deliberate, premeditated execution and extrajudicial killing for which the state of Saudi Arabia is responsible under international law. Turkish intelligence and the CIA both concluded with high confidence that Khashoggi's murder was ordered by Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman. In opposition to the White House, the United States Senate has unanimously passed a resolution that held MBS responsible for the death of Khashoggi. In the U.S. House of Representatives, the bipartisan Saudi Arabia Human Rights and Accountability Act of 2019 was also added as an amendment to the 2020 National Defense Authorization Act. That is now something the Senate needs to agree to in conference committee. This amendment would order the administration to submit to Congress a public report presenting all relevant evidence, a full list of those who are believed to be involved in Khashoggi's murder, and to slap visa restrictions on those involved. These sanctions can only be lifted when Saudi authorities stop the torture and imprisonment of women's rights activists. Accountability is achievable. It's this administration, President Trump, who delays and denies justice. I now have two goals in the next year to achieve justice for Jamal. That we demand accountability from the government and we get that report, and that we hold MBS accountable, and that we also have this street where we stand here now, renamed Khashoggi Way, as a reminder to the Saudi government that you can kill the messenger, but you cannot kill his message. With that, speaking next is Medea Benjamin, co-founder of Code Pink. Thank you.
It's a sad occasion coming together to remember the gruesome murder of Jamal Khashoggi. But I think it's important we also take a moment to just look at this place and think of it for what it is, which is a place of evil. Saudi Arabia, the government of Saudi Arabia, is an evil government. Mohammed bin Salman, who was celebrated 2 years ago when he came to the United States and was feted by our officials in Congress, in the White House, in the business world, as a reformer, he is an evil man who belongs in The Hague. And I think justice for Jamal Khashoggi will be when Mohammed bin Salman is being tried for the crimes that he has committed, including the war crimes in Yemen that he is committing on a daily basis. I also think it's horrible that President Trump, instead of distancing himself from Mohammed bin Salman, has tightened the embrace in the last year. And this is a year not only after the grisly murder, but a year in which he has thrown women activists into prison and tortured them. A year in which human rights lawyers have been thrown into prison. A year in which anybody who dissents against his repressive rule has been thrown into prison. And Donald Trump has not only vetoed the bills that we have helped to send to Congress to say no more support for the Saudi war in Yemen, but he has also helped to rehabilitate Mohammed bin Salman on the world stage. So I am here today as a representative of Code Pink to announce an increase that we will do in a campaign to boycott Saudi Arabia. This includes putting pressure on businesses to stop their business deals with the Saudi regime. There is a gathering coming up at the end of October known as Davos in the Desert. It is said that Jared Kushner is going to be leading it with a delegation of US businesses, including BlackRock, Citicorp, and other Wall Street firms. We are calling on these companies not to go to Davos in the desert. We are calling on the G20, who have said that their next meeting is going to be in Saudi Arabia. How horrible is that? They must not do their next meeting in Saudi Arabia. We are calling on the think tanks in Washington, D.C., on the Ivy League schools in this country to stop taking money, dirty money, blood money, from the Saudi regime. We are calling on the PR firms who earn millions of dollars every month from trying to whitewash the crimes of this government to stop representing the Saudi regime. And we are calling on entertainers who are part of this whole cover-up to say Saudi Arabia is reforming. Look, we now have singers coming in and concerts. We call on those very entertainers to not go entertain in Saudi Arabia, to follow in the footsteps of Nicki Minaj, who said because of the repression against gay people, against women, and violations of human rights in general, she would not perform in Saudi Arabia. So this is a message to all of those out there who continue to take blood money from Saudi Arabia. The time has come to cut your ties with this bloody regime, and certainly a message for Donald Trump, while he himself is under the spotlight, to sever his ties with the bloody regime. And let's hope that next year we can come back and say the Crown Prince of Saudi Arabia is in The Hague. Thank you.
Thank you, Medea. Next speaking is American Muslims for Palestine National Policy Director, Dr. Osama Abu Irshaid.
Good afternoon. A few days ago, in an interview with CBS News, Saudi Crown Prince Mohammed bin Salman claimed that he takes full responsibility as the leader of Saudi Arabia for the gruesome murder of Jamal Khashoggi, since it was committed by individuals working for the Saudi government. However, he still denies that he personally ordered and directed the murder as confirmed by the Turkish and the American intelligence agencies, as well as UN officials. MBS is a proven war criminal and a brutal dictator. No matter how hard he tries to disguise his ugly face behind the claims of reform, the facts speak for themselves. We see them in Yemen, where he destroyed the country, massacred its people, causing famine and reviving diseases that we thought were long gone. Yet, he is unable to win the war. In Saudi Arabia, he cracked down on women and human rights activists, as well as scholars. He even persecuted members of his own royal family and business people under the pretext of fighting corruption, while he himself is the most corrupt figure in Saudi Arabia today. Moreover, although he claims to take moral responsibility for the murder of Khashoggi, no one has been prosecuted for the crime in Saudi Arabia until today. No one has been tried, no one has been convicted, and after a year since the crime, Khashoggi's body is still missing. Until today, they claim they don't know where they disposed the body. This shows the true nature of the regime of MBS, or the true nature of the regime MBS has established. In his view, reform means tightening his grip over power, while baiting the international community by presenting himself as a reformist. We know, though, of one person who took the bait willingly, and that is the man who MBS cares the most about, the president, President Donald Trump. Trump is the enabler of MBS. He does not hide his admiration for tyrants. In fact, he might be envying them for having absolute power with disregard to their people and the institutions. He never shied away from shielding MBS from the consequences of his crime. Trump's argument was that Khashoggi is not an American citizen and that the kingdom buys a lot of US weapons, the same weapons that are wreaking havoc in Yemen and the same weapon that are murdering Yemeni women and children today. As low as this argument by the president that Khashoggi is not an American citizen, maybe it is time to remind him that MBS jails American citizens like Dr. Waleed Iftahi, who was arrested back in 2017 with confirmed reports that he's been subjected to torture until today. The president does not see this or tend to turn a blind eye to this, and he does not care. After all, why should he care if he himself is threatening a civil war in the United States if he is going to be impeached and removed by Congress? After 1 year, justice is yet to find its way in Khashoggi's case. Justice requires that MBS have his day before the ICC for the war crimes he committed and is still committing, and not to be treated as an international, as a world leader, as he is being treated today. One last point that I want to make. If you remember 1 year ago, the Saudi consulate in Istanbul claimed that their surveillance cameras weren't working. So I want to give you the good news. Since we're standing outside, no one should worry, because they're not video recording our press conference here, according to their claims. The bad news, if anyone would walk in, bad for you, because no one will have evidence that you walked in according to their claims. Everyone knows that the Saudis are lying. Everyone knows that these cameras are working. Everyone knows that the Saudis are lying, and they're finding a president who is receptive to their deception, because he's no less crooked than MBS. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Next speaking is Nonviolence International human rights attorney Jonathan Kuttab.
Thank you very much. We are gathered here on what is probably a very sad occasion, but it's also a very positive time for us to remember that the language, the values, the principles, and the institutions of human rights and international law are becoming stronger and stronger every day. Even the Saudi regime and the other Arab regimes openly talk as if they believe in reform, as if they believe in democracy, as if they believe in granting rights to everyone. Even the prince himself, the number one suspect in this gruesome crime, is willing to say openly that he is shocked by the crime that took place under his authority and that he is trying to prevent it from happening again and bringing those responsible for judgment. Now, this creates a paradox where people like us who believe in human rights and freedom seem to be winning precisely at the time when we seem to be losing and weak and defeated. We are not defeated. We are winning the battle for the hearts and minds of the entire world. The ones who are losing are the ones who are the criminals, the human rights violators, the ones who know that despite all their power and might, their day may well come. Not only will history find them guilty, but they may even be actually brought to justice during their lifetime. This is really the good news that we must keep that hope alive. We also have our task at hand. We need to bridge the gap between the values and the principles that everybody increasingly is accepted and the gruesome reality on the ground that these rights are being violated. We need to redouble our efforts so that those currently today in jail can be released and those currently in power today can be deposed and brought to justice. This is not an easy fight. It's a continuing fight, which we must fight with the weapons of light against the weapons of darkness and against the forces of darkness. This is where the press, this is where civil society institutions, this is where the courts and the lawyers and international law comes in. And this is where ordinary individuals can also participate through boycotts, as we heard, through divestment of corporations that are involved in this gruesome affair, and through sanctions against the criminals who are carrying out these actions. BDS are really tactics. They are weapons of light against the forces of darkness. So whoever the evil ones are, and wherever the violations occur, whether it's in Saudi Arabia, in Palestine, in Kashmir, and everywhere, the universal human rights should be upheld, and those who are violating them should be brought to justice. This is our job, and that's what we must do. Thank you.
Thank you. Next speaking, we have Hassan Al Taib, Middle East Policy Lead at the Friends Committee on National Legislation. Thank you.
Thanks. Thank you all for being here today. A year ago, Jamal Khashoggi walked into a Saudi consulate in Istanbul, Turkey, and disappeared. And over the past year, the official story from the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia changed more times than I can count. In a 60 Minutes interview over the weekend, though, Mohammed bin Salman said that he was responsible as the leader of Saudi Arabia, but at the same time, he denied having any involvement. How could I possibly keep track of 3 million people that work for our government? But anybody who knows anything about Saudi Arabia doesn't buy this story. The international community doesn't buy this story. The US Senate does not buy this story. The story about Khashoggi uncovered another often untold story in America. The story of the forgotten war in Yemen and US participation in that war. And I think it's fair to say that Khashoggi's murder did what the death of over 100,000 Yemeni children under the age of 5 who died from hunger and disease could not do. That being getting the US media and Americans to pay attention to human rights abuses by the Kingdom of Saudi Arabia, at home and abroad. The hypocritical nature of the mainstream coverage is especially painful for so many people up here and so many people out in the community, myself included, who've been for years trying to bring attention to the suffering of Yemeni men, women, and children. How many deaths will it take before investing in Saudi Arabia becomes a problem? Or human rights only matter when a prominent figure is the subject of this kind of brutality? For the past 5 years, the United States has backed the Saudi-UAE coalition's war in Yemen and have helped create the world's worst humanitarian crisis on the planet, leaving 14 million people on the brink of famine, 1.3 million cases of cholera. Saudi Arabia and the Emirates have blockaded the ports of Yemen, cutting off the flow of food, fuel, medicine, and clean water. They have done airstrikes on schools, hospitals, weddings. They've done airstrikes on economic and agricultural infrastructure. They've been using starvation as a weapon and causing the collapse of the entire Yemeni economy, their healthcare and educational systems. Mohammed bin Salman has proven himself to be a ruthless dictator and monarch, not the progressive reformer that he tries to pretend that he is and that so many people in the West have gone along with. Even now, he's trying to give his public image a facelift, going on 60 Minutes or, you know, paying millions of dollars to lobbyists in D.C. and paying money to think tanks to make sure that the Saudi image is kept up. But despite the aimless Yemen war being unwinnable in conventional terms, despite the illegality as this war was not authorized by Congress, and despite the astounding number of civilian casualties in this reckless and ruthless bombing campaign, Trump has given Mohammed bin Salman a blank check to keep this going. In the past year, much has changed, though. Khashoggi's murder shed light on the forgotten war and helped people open their eyes to the suffering in Yemen. And while the situation for Yemenis remains very bleak, I think there's still reason to believe in peace in Yemen. I was elated when Congress made history this year and passed the Yemen War Powers Resolution for the first time in 45 years. By invoking the War Powers Act, Congress put pressure on the Trump administration and by Saudi Arabia and the Emirates and the whole coalition to stop mid-air refueling of Saudi warplanes. It also helped bring the sides to the peace table and agree on a ceasefire in Hodeidah, Yemen's largest port and main supply line of aid to millions of people. And while that ceasefire is fragile, the suffering in Yemen remains catastrophic. I think that this effort by Congress and the activists you see here today has helped millions of Yemenis. But there's more to do. Despite Trump's veto of SJ Res 7 in April, Congress has another historic opportunity in the National Defense Authorization Act through House-Senate joint conference negotiations. There's legislation in there that could cut off all weapons sales, could end logistical support to the coalition, and stop spare parts transfers to the coalition. And we can finally bring an end to our participation in this brutal, unjust, illegal war and finish what we started with the Yemen War Powers Resolution. Congress has the power to end our complicity, and they must use that power to end this war and bring an end to the war in Yemen and to bring justice to Jamal Khashoggi. Thank you.
Thank you very much. No problem.
Just illuminate the predicament confronting all Saudis. We are being asked to abandon any hope of political freedom and to keep quiet about arrest and travel bans that impact not only the critics, but also their families. We are expected to vigorously applaud social reforms and heap praise on the Crown Prince.
Send MBS to the Hague!
Send MBS to the Hague!
Is there no other way for us? His vision of our future, in exchange for the right to live, economic reforms, the blockade of Qatar, discussions about an alliance with Israel to counter Iran, and last year's imprisonment of dozens of Saudi intellectuals and clerics. This is the choice I've woken up to each morning. I have left my home, my family, and my job, and I am raising my voice. To do otherwise would betray those who languish in prison. I can speak when so many cannot. I want you to know that Saudi Arabia has not always been as it is now. We Saudis deserve better. Don't be cowards, don't be vague, send MBS to the Hague. Don't be cowards, don't be vague, send MBS to the Hague.
Saudis who speak out face imprisonment, face death, and also face repression of their families. One could ask, why aren't there Saudis here with us today speaking out? And the answer is very clear, fear. And so we know the most brutal case, the one of Khashoggi, but we also have to recognize that there are many, many, many Saudis languishing in prison. There are many Saudi dissidents around the world afraid to speak out, not only for their own well-being, but for that of their families. So this is really an occasion where the rest of us have to speak out for those Saudis who can't. And that's why Jamal Khashoggi was so special, because he did realize, as things got worse and worse in Saudi Arabia, that he had to speak out. And I guess he thought, as many of us thought, that working for the Washington Post would be some protection. Absolutely. And unfortunately, that was not enough to keep him protected.
Chopping up Jamal Khashoggi.
Saudi is a terrorist state.
Imprisoning women activists.
Saudi is a terrorist state.
Bombing children in Yemen.
Saudi is a terrorist state.
Putting human rights activists in prison.
Saudi is a terrorist state.
Repressing all religious freedom.
Saudi is a terrorist state.
Repressing guest workers.
Saudi is a terrorist state.
Exporting Wahhabi terrorism.
Saudi is a terrorist state.
Putting women in prison.
Saudi is a terrorist state.
Torturing women prisoners.
Saudi is a terrorist state.
Executing gays.
Saudi is a terrorist state.
Bombing weddings in Yemen.
Saudi is a terrorist state.
Starving Yemeni children.
Saudi is a terrorist state.
There are unfortunately all too many reasons for calling Saudi a terrorist state. And the people who are suffering in Yemen, and all those who are victims of the repression in Saudi Arabia. I think we had great words here from the speakers.